I'd like to thank Ms. Young and Mr. Lister James advisory groups for greeting us as we came in today. And thanks for the residents of French 1 and 2 for accepting the chapel challenge to lead our mealtime blessings this week. It is good to hear different voices and viewpoints up there. Remember that it is possible to express gratitude in many different ways, through prayer, in different languages, through silent reflection, and maybe even through song. The more creativity, the better. The more different ages, the better. So with that in mind, French 1 and 2, who would you like to challenge this week?
We'd like to challenge
the chapel assistants. Okay, chapel assistants, do you accept?
Yeah.
Let's give us a round of applause.
I'm going to ring this chime, and after 1 minute of mindful breathing, I will ring the chime again. Good job, everyone. Now, please join me in welcoming everyone's favorite faculty band, Grades and Comments.
I got it. Mr. and Mrs. McCusker.
Faculty, Cardigan brothers, sons, and grandsons. Think a lot of you guys as brothers. I look in the mirror, I see a man that's aging, but I don't feel like I'm aging. I feel like I'm still young and vibrant. And it's because of you guys. You guys make me feel that way. So thanks for that. Last year I took Alonzo Garza under my wing, and when he had a really bad accident from skiing, I went and saw his family and he in a hotel room a couple times as he was convalescing. And I told his parents that I felt like I was his father. And his mother said, "Well, Alonzo thinks you more as a grandfather." So thank you for this chance to speak to my brothers, sons, and grandsons. Like most of us, I'm nervous to be up here. And yeah, Mr. Burt, how can that be? You get up in front of people and play the guitar all the time, but it's not quite the same. I still end up getting butterflies every single time I get before a crowd. But then you get out there and you start playing, and I know the guitar, I know what I'm doing, and I also have a very forgiving audience, so thanks. When I was 11 years old, I joined the world of scouting. It's the Boy Scouts of America. It's a national organization that has the lofty goal of guiding young men, boys, into becoming young men. It's done by instilling values set forth in the Scout Oath and the Scout Law. On my honor, I'll do my best to do my duty to God and my country, to obey the Scout Law, to help other people at all times, to keep myself physically strong, mentally awake, and morally straight. Scout is trustworthy, loyal, helpful, friendly, courteous, kind, obedient, cheerful, thrifty, brave, clean, and reverent. Sounds a lot like our mission statement and our core values, doesn't it? I entered as a tenderfoot. That's a greenhorn. I knew nothing about what I was getting involved with. It's a boy-run program where the adults are there to provide guidance, but it's really the boys who run the show. The older, experienced scouts work with the new scouts. It's a student-teacher relationship where the teachers are fellow scouts. Everyone learns from each other by teaching important life skills, developing character, working to improve physical and mental fitness, and striving to become better citizens. The outdoor program is the training ground for learning about cooking and camping, first aid, knots, lashings, hiking, backpacking, shelter building. Shades of Outdoor Survival Club. As I got older, the one being taught became the one doing the teaching. The skills that I had been introduced to me were practiced, mastered, and then I introduced them to the new guys that were coming on board. I became a leader. I went to leadership council meetings. I found myself embracing and using leadership skills that my predecessors had taught me. I'm forever grateful to them for their guidance. One of my clearest memories was a trip that was organized to take all of us and put us out into a remote area and set up camp alone, away from each other. It was dark. There were stars, but no moon. I was cold, shaking actually, and I'm not quite sure if it was the cold or fear, because I'd never been alone before. I gathered firewood by flashlight, got a fire going. Then I began to warm up. Not so lonely anymore, not so scared, not so alone. I set up a shelter by firelight, boiled water for soup, hot chocolate. It's no longer cold, or lonely, or scared. A warm fire can do that. I woke in the morning, I made scrambled eggs, bacon, and walked out and joined my fellow scouts, and we talked the rest of the morning about our adventure alone in the woods. I was 14 years old. How did I know how to do all that? from those older boys who showed me how to survive in the outdoors. They taught me, they prepared me, they tested me, and they enlightened me. My confidence grew. I began to believe in myself and my abilities. Yeah, it's scary. It's nerve-wracking at first. Then you settle into the task at hand, and you draw on all those who gave you a hand along the way and provided you with the tools, the skills, the knowledge, and the encouragement to tackle the challenges ahead. Boys, take a look around you. You are in paradise. I've been to 47 of the 50 states, backpacked through many of them, hitched rides, hopped trains, for weeks and months at a time, carried everything I needed on my backpack. Eventually, I came to New Hampshire and I settled here at Cardigan. The air is clear. The water is the tastiest anywhere in the country. It's gorgeous here. Look at those spacious skies, those amber waves of grain. Dig them purple mountain majesties. I'll bet there's fruit out there on the plain. You guys know me. I'm a man of much experience, many talents. I could work and live anywhere. I choose to be here. Why? Because I care about what we are doing here, and I care about you. Every faculty member here is here because they believe in that same dream, in the Cardigan way. Mr. McCusker often says, it is unlikely you will be in a community where so many people know you as well and care about you as much as your teachers at Cardigan. This is home. It's our home. It's a pretty messed up world out there, and the leaders who now have their hands on the reins, I don't have a lot of hope in them. Any hope for real change and real solutions is going to come from guys like you and others who value honesty, integrity, respect, fairness, compassion, and scholarship. You have a little more than 5 weeks left. Ninth graders have an opportunity to finish strong, to make a few marks, leave a few reminders that you were here and made a difference. Reach out to your Cardigan brothers and share what you know and what you've learned. They look up to you. They want to emulate the things that you do and the way you do them. Lift them as you continue to climb. And to all those who will return next year, there are equal opportunities for you too. Leadership positions will soon be vacated by those who graduate, and a new generation of student leaders will emerge. Will you be prepared? Will you know what to do? How will you know? Take as many pages as possible from those young men who have demonstrated they are worthy of the roles and their responsibilities. Some do it well, some do it extremely well. Ask, absorb, mimic, expand, imagine, integrate, then energize. Go for the big one, because all limitations are self-imposed. And own this place. Hold fast to all that is good about Cardigan and all that you have learned. Take it with you. Let the lessons and memories be the light that guides your soul. Above all, be humble and kind. Cardigan is and always will be your home. Thank you very much.
Oh, Guys, we had planned to end with the Cardigan hymn, as we usually do, but I think that Mr. Burritt's last song, Always Be Humble and Kind, is about one of the best benedictions that we could have. So I'm going to change things up a little bit. I ask you now to please join me in prayer or in silent reflection. Gracious God, we thank you for this glorious spring day. Thank you for giving us the opportunity to sit quietly right here in the midst of paradise. As we go outside today, help us to be open to your touch. Use the fresh breeze to clear our thinking, the sunshine to warm and brighten the cold, dark corners of our hearts, the peace and quiet to help us turn our attention to your great love for us. Show each of us how we can be the best versions of ourselves and how we can use the gifts you have given us to serve others. Amen. Boys, in just a minute, I've asked Mr. Scheiber and Mr. Auerbach to deliver our benediction in honor of Passover, which we're celebrating. And then with no further ado, during the postlude, Jalen and Andre will release you all, dismiss you all from the back. Please go outside, just as we did 2 weeks ago with your advisor. Find a place to be. Please don't talk. Just enjoy this silence and keep that strong silence until you hear the chime at 2:30. Thank you.
Read the benediction once in Hebrew and once in English. Yismechem Elohim ke'Ephraim v'chi Manasseh.
God should set you up like Ephraim and like Manasseh.
Yivarechecha Adonai v'yishmerecha.
God should set you up like Sarah, Rivka, Rachel, and Leah. Right there. Adonai should bless you and guard you. Adonai should direct the light of his face towards you and treat you graciously. Adonai should direct his face towards you and grant you peace.
Ya'er Adonai panav elecha v'chuneka, Yisa Adonai panav elecha v'yesem lecha shalom.